we said at the end of the conclusion, we said if we are given sigma, we compute clean closure of it, and the language that we define would be subset of clean closure. And when we said language, language would be some set of elements rather, or set of strings rather, which can be constructed or which can be added, or the elements can be added into that set, provided some condition is matching there. Correct. So, like considering the development in computation, a development in computer science rather, or to be specifically, like to be specific on the point, when we said languages, okay, programming languages, the idea came into picture, like how exactly the program should be written. So should it be in a way that generally like your spoken languages are, or there should be something else. Now, multiple researchers started working around it. Now, it's not only about designing a language. It was even related to something, some aspects like, for example, how exactly you are going to get, or you are going to verify whether whatever the statement, whatever the string that was given to you is really part of that language or not. Like, for example, that day I gave you example, like if I jumble the words, rather jumble the position of word, like in spoken languages, we may not use that as a proper statement, but somehow like towards end, one can come up or one can end up by saying, okay, it seems to be some kind of say poem. Okay, some kind of poem. Now, when we do talk about such kind of aspect, rather, how exactly we are going to verify this? And that is the reason, like while there was a researcher called Noam Chomsky. What he did was he came up with for example, division in terms of how the languages should be, or what kind of language should be, and so on. So what he did, he came up with something called as Chomsky hierarchy. Okay. Now this hierarchy he defined in terms of four categories. He came up with four categories, like total four types. So he gave names to them as type 0, type 1, type 2, and type 3. And these types he defined with respect to a terminology called grammar, which is one of the most important aspect of every language. Generally in programming languages, you call it as syntax. Fine. How exactly one should come up with a statement or set of statements rather, which can lead to say that this particular group of statements is valid as per the syntax of the language. So let us try to address what exactly this grammar means. Okay. Now, when we do talk about a grammar, we have to define that grammar in this way. So there was a proper definition given. A grammar G is defined with four tuples. Tuples means components. Okay. Mainly represented as Vn, sigma, P, and S. Where he the definition contains description of each element, Vn, sigma, P, S. Now let us type out, let us identify what exactly this Vn means. So Vn is set of, or you can say non-empty set of variables, or you can say non-terminals. Now, whenever you do talk about syntax of a language, rather, you must have seen a program contains set of statements. Now, what kind of statements are? So you say assignment statement, you say condition statement, and so on. So how exactly you verify them? So like when I say condition, when I say statement, okay, or when I say assignment, they are the representations. Okay, now depending upon the language, representation may vary. How exactly you are going to denote them? Notation mechanisms may vary. But in short, we are going to call that as set of variables or non-terminals. There is an element, another element called sigma, which even is sometimes empty. So I'm not specifically right now talking or writing non-empty, but I'm saying set of symbols or terminals. So now you will see, like I'm using these specific terms, non-terminals and terminals, in context of programming languages. Okay, that's why. Okay, thirdly, this S is special start symbol. This S belongs to VN. Now, whenever I do talk about this VN, intersection sigma should be fine. This is really, really important. You should not make any kind of jumble with respect to these two sets. Both the sets should be different. Okay, both the sets should be different. With respect to definition of P, it is set of productions or rules of the form alpha gives beta. Now, what this alpha and beta really results to, or what exactly they are? So, like when alpha, whenever I do talk about alpha and beta, alpha comma beta belongs to VN union sigma star. Now, what exactly this VN union sigma star means? Say, for example, like recall the definition that we saw in the previous session. Okay, let me come up with. So we said, if I have sigma to be this, if I have sigma star to be this. So let me say, if I have sigma to be AB, and if I have sigma dash to be say 0, 1, what would be sigma union sigma dash? If I write the union, what would be sigma union sigma dash? Yes. If I take union. Yeah.
That's AB 01.
AB 01. Now this itself is one set, correct? So whenever I'm writing this sigma union sigma dash, suppose if I represent this by A, for example, so what would be A star? So as per the definition that we saw, whenever we have sigma to be 0, 1, say for example, whenever we are computing sigma star, it is epsilon 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, and so on. Correct. So similarly, whenever I'm talking about this A star is, A is representing this sigma union sigma dash set. And so what would be A star? Epsilon A B 0 1 AA AB A0 A1, correct? And you do, you go on. Now you type BA BB B0 B1 0A 0B 0 0 0 1 then 1A 1B, correct? Then 1 0 1 1, and so on. So similarly, you are going to get this set. Look, this will result to all possible strings with varying length. Now length starting with 0, then 1, then 2, then 3, like I wrote right now here up till 2 only, but it can move further. Like for example, in this case I took 1 0 0, even I can go on with respect to creating this set, correct? So whenever I'm saying VN union sigma star, so suppose your VN is like, what we are going to do is, we are going to make use of specific notation. Every capital character, almost every time, whenever we are referring capital characters, they would be variables. Say, for example, S, A, B, so on, all capital characters. So they may be having say, for example, suffix A1, B1, C1, so on, correct? But they should be capital. Now we are going to represent small a, small b, small c, say, for example, 0, 1, as elements from sigma. Okay, they can be, depending upon the language, what exactly they would be different. Correct. They could be like, we are going to mostly use a, b, c, and 0, 1 kind of stuff, 0, 1, 2, and so on. So they would be sigma. Now, we are going to use small case characters again to represent something called a string. So we are going to represent X, Y, Z, W. These would be the representations that we are going to make use of to represent strings. So, okay, so note this down somewhere. Like, we are going to make use of VN, which would be set of variables, which would be capital case. Sigma, it is set of terminals, which would be in small case. It can be ABC or it can be 0, 1, 2. Now you may say, what if XYZW is there? Probably yes, they can be part of your sigma, but whenever we have to represent, then we have to make use of something different. So we are going to take examples so specific that we will try avoiding using these symbols as a part of sigma. So as to differentiate. Now, suppose at all your language contains these, then you use some different symbols like X1, XY, X1, Y1, Z1, W1. Okay, but they should be small case to represent the string. So we are going to make use of these symbols rather to represent each respective set and a string too. Correct. Now, suppose VN contains AB, let us say SA. Okay, sigma contains say 0, 1. So what would be VN union sigma star? What would be this set? So like, as it is a set, I'm going to write this in curly bracket. What would be this set? Vn contains 2, sigma contains 2. It is similar to this. Correct. So we will start with epsilon, then S, then A, then 0, then 1, and so on. The way that we wrote this, correct? Now, as per our production rule, set of productions or rules, we said it is of the form alpha gives beta, where alpha and beta would be one of them. So we are going to make sure that on the production side, left hand side never will contain epsilon. Like, whenever I do see this, it could be like this. For example, a variable giving you an empty string or an empty symbol. Correct. Now your production, something would be like this. A gives AB. AA gives BA, something like this. So I'm giving this as a generalized case. So like, whenever we are forming these rules, they would be of this form. So there is no limit on like what should be towards left side, what should be there towards right side. So you may say like, this may be possible, epsilon is epsilon, but you don't use this. We are never going to use this. Fine. Any question till this time? Have you understood definition of a grammar?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we will be moving with now this categorization. So we said there would be four types of grammars through the Chomsky hierarchy that he gave, Noam Chomsky gave. Now those grammars are differentiated with respect to, these types are differentiated with respect to these production types. How exactly you are writing the productions? Okay, so let me go. So let me go with the types now. So let us say if I write type 0, every production of the type alpha gives beta, where alpha comma beta belongs to VN union sigma star. Every production would be called as type 0 production by default. This is a basis for our understanding. Fine. So I will say a grammar is referred as type 0 if production set contains all the productions of the form alpha gives beta, where alpha, beta, this, then it is called as type 1 grammar. So this is how I'm going to define this type 1. Sorry, type 0. How exactly I'm going to define type 0? Type 0 grammar is defined as a grammar whose production set contains all productions of the form alpha gives beta, where alpha and beta belongs to VN union sigma star. Done. Your definition of type 0 is done. Let us talk about now type 1. Now you will see, like, some of you may be wondering now, why exactly are we talking about these types? Why it is necessary for us to really go with this? They would be the basis for the languages to be defined. Like, how exactly your languages would be understood, or how exactly your languages would be differentiated. Correct? So, like, the grammar of the type 0 is referred as, name given to it is unstructured grammar. Fine, unstructured grammar. Now what about type 1 then? We should know now how exactly we are going to consider now this type 1. This type 1 would have some constraints now. So in general, whenever I do talk about this hierarchy, okay, we give name to this, or what Chomsky did. He said type 1 grammar would be known as context sensitive grammar. Fine, context sensitive grammar. Now we need to know then how exactly the form would be. How exactly this form would be. Now we are going to have some restriction. Every grammar of the form. Okay, now I'm writing this. Every grammar of the form. Now I'm keeping some amount of space here. Okay, so after and before. So there would be alpha and beta. Alpha beta definition would be remaining as it is. Now I have something specific over here, which is referred as, suppose, A and B. Here also I am writing A and B. In this case, this A is called as left context, and this B is called as right context. So you are going to keep the context firm. One more thing, whenever we are talking about this alpha and beta, length of alpha is always less than equal to length of beta. Sometimes length would be same. Almost every time, when I said every time, considering this equal to condition as well, your bit length of beta is more. So I'm talking about now the number of symbols in alpha and beta. I don't care what is there with alpha, because I do have alpha and beta represented as this. So that is the reason why do we call it as context sensitive. The context should remain. Now suppose suddenly, like while this class is going on, suddenly I talk about a movie. Spider-Man's new movie. Now suddenly you will wonder what happened exactly. then somehow if I am talking about a movie, then somehow I need to conclude by saying, okay, now what exactly theory of computation component was used there? So I have to maintain the context. Suppose I lose the context, ultimately it would be difficult for an individual to remember what was going on. So some of you might be interested in talking about that movie too. But then context may be lost. Correct? So we whenever we have to preserve this context, that's why this it is called as context sensitive. You have to preserve the context, left context and right context. Okay. Now if whenever I am talking about this, rather this hierarchy, this rather gives me the syntactic structure. These types give me the syntactic structure of the, say for example, the languages. What are the languages that we do really talk about? Most of the times, whenever we are dealing with this. So whenever I said this, ultimately I'm going to replace this to make so specific this thing. So now let me rewrite this. So for a while, how exactly I'm going to write this? So I'm going to write like this. So if I have alpha to be left context, A to be a variable and beta to be right context, then I would be having alpha, gamma, beta. Okay, where length of A means this is only one symbol here towards left side along with this alpha and beta. Alpha, beta would be again like we will keep this context. Most of the times they are combinations of VN and sigma, terminals and non-terminals, strings of terminals and non-terminals. So I'm, because in this case, I would be talking about all single context. But what if I have huge string towards left and huge strings towards right? So this would be a specific case, like where I will be having only single element. But what if I have a generalized view? The generalized view would be what? Always there would be a symbol one. And this symbol would be replaced by set of symbols. But we have to make sure that this alpha should not be empty. Sorry, not alpha, gamma. Gamma should not be empty. It should not be an empty string. Sorry, I said alpha. I'm talking about gamma. This gamma should not be empty. That means what? You should never have a production called A gives epsilon. Whenever we are talking about context sensitive grammar. This alpha and beta may be empty sometimes. This alpha and beta may be empty. You may not have at all any string because they may result to epsilon. Correct? If I go with the formation mechanism of this sigma VN union sigma star. Now in such a case rather, in this case rather, whenever I'm dealing with this gamma should never be epsilon. Length of A. Now, if it is like this, that is the reason why we wrote this. Okay. It should be less than equal to gamma, length of gamma. Okay. So this will give us a specific definition of our type 1 grammar. Every grammar G is called as type 1. If all of its productions are of the form alpha A beta gives alpha gamma beta, where gamma is never epsilon and length of variables towards left, like I'm talking about this A, length of A is A in this case, correct? Only one. This where A belongs to, you can specifically write this VN. That means this should be a symbol, single symbol, which is a non-terminal. This can be replaced by gamma. This gamma should never be epsilon. And whenever I'm talking about number of symbols in A and gamma, they should be either same or symbols in gamma should be more than A. This A can never be epsilon. Like this gamma can never be epsilon. That means you're talking about this case. Okay. So this would be called as context sensitive grammar. Any question, please? If any, let me move to next now.
Sir, this but in what kind of situation will we use this kind of a computation?
Okay. Now the thing is, like, for example, like, by the way, like, while I finish these four cases, I would be telling you, like, in first session, what are the first session that you must have seen a recorded video. Okay, there I talked about four different machines. Correct. I started with finite automata. Then I said there will be pushdown automata, Turing machine, linear bounded automata. These all four machines are associated with each type of these types. Okay. Now, whenever you are dealing with something, like, for example, right now, whenever I'm talking about concluding with set of statements, every programming language, like, for example, let me ask you to write a program. Can you write a program which will verify whether the given program is C program or not? How will you define this? How will you check it? So you are going to see the template. You are going to validate the statements for whether they are syntactically correct or not. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Whatever the way. Now, can you give me what would be this set of C programs? It is going to be an infinite set. And that's how, whenever you are coming up with a language, you need to know what kind of mistakes the individual is going to make. That's how you come up with or end up with having syntax errors known. Every programming language designer should understand, should know what are the different errors, possible errors that a particular individual can have in a program, can make in a program. Now, suppose you forgot to add one error, forgot to address one error. Like, for example, if I talk about Windows 98 as an operating system, like, if you search on Google saying that, say, what is blue screen error? Have you heard about this? Simply, what happens, what used to happen with Windows NT, Windows 90, sorry, 98, then Windows XP, even Windows 10. If you search on Google, rather, if you have machine available with you, search about it, like, blue screen error Windows 10. So you will see, like, this error, haven't they thought about this earlier when they came up with operating system structure of Windows? They came up with, but suddenly, like, something is happening, suddenly your machine stops working and it says, after 10, 50 seconds, I'm going to reboot, take backup of it. And it doesn't give any control to you at all. Maybe you can search about this. I'm giving you, say, info. I am giving you, like, for example, an input for it. Like, try to find out what is this blue screen error. Now, you may say, in what context I'm talking about this? Whenever I am talking about design of any computation mechanism, I need to know what would be the possible errors that can occur in computation. Correct. So if at all, whenever I'm having some restrictions on computation, like, for example, I'm defining a problem where all possible constraints are described. Now, can you follow all possible constraints? Probably yes, depending upon what is the structure of the program, what is the structure of the system. But if you are given, like, for example, I'm asking you to sit in a room and I'm saying, don't touch this, don't touch this, don't do this. Will you be able to survive for some amount of minutes? Maybe you may survive for some amount of minutes. What happens after that? Like, suppose if I say you have to enter, you are not to touch any part of the objects available inside a room. But ultimately, I can conclude, okay, now your legs are, or your shoes are touching to the floor. So, like, how exactly I'm going to follow up or execute this kind of restriction? There is a restriction applied, and that's what, whenever you do see some restriction, then that restriction is occurring because of this. That is the reason why we are talking about context sensitive. So I'll be giving you example after a while, probably in next class, because next one or two classes, like today's class and maybe two, three classes more, probably they are related with each other. That time you will understand what is significance of this context sensitiveness. Fine, Allah?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, so let us move with now type 2. Now, this type 2 is one of the most important aspect in for every programmer, rather. Most of. Now, really, like whenever I'm talking about a syntax perspective, like how exactly I'm going to identify some grammar to be context free. So this, okay, let me give the name. So this type 2 grammar is called as whenever you are working with natural language processing, application of natural language processing heavily depends on this type 2. That is context-free grammar. Most of the NLP practitioners, or you can say researchers, are heavily using this. Even our most of the languages, programming languages, are of this type 2. It is very simple form. Like here we had left and right context. Correct, but we had a restriction. This gamma can never be epsilon. Okay, now in this case for type 2, it is like this. Every production of the form A gives alpha, where A belongs to Vn, that means a single non-terminal, and alpha belongs to Vn union sigma star. So this can be epsilon in this case. This can be epsilon. This alpha can be epsilon. So every production of the form A gives alpha would be called as a type 2 production. A grammar which contains all productions of the form A gives alpha, where A belongs to Vn and alpha belongs to Vn union sigma star, then such a grammar is called as context-free grammar. And application of it can be seen mostly, as I said, as I pointed out, is in NLP. Even our programming languages heavily are following this. So definitely I'm going to show you some cases on computer system, like how exactly it is built. Okay, this one. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let me go to now next type. Type 3. Now you saw completely free structure. That's why unstructured. Or in some form or in some books, it also is referred as this. Now I haven't specifically wrote it, but we will be using this word, recursively enumerable language. Now don't ask me right now what does it mean. We are going to address in Turing machine completely what exactly is recursively enumerable means. There is no structure given. Like while you type messages on WhatsApp, do you use any restrictions of language? Is there any language barrier now? While you type message, while you type, message on WhatsApp, whenever you write mails, whenever you post something, it is free. It is free. You don't use any syntax specifically of a language. Even our machine can fail in understanding what exactly is happening. That is the reason why the conversion is made in terms of transliteration. It is not translation. Whatever you type, if you recall that day, I gave you an example of what exactly, how exactly one can type the text when you speak. When you speak, rather, everything would be understood by the system and it is going to display it on the screen. Now, whenever we are talking about this, like for example, whenever I'm talking about a mobile system, rather. Okay, let me show you. I assume I must have shown it, but let me show you some part of it. Okay. Let me take TCS course. Yeah. Now you may see probably here, like I have given you an example earlier as well. So let us see this. whatever I am saying is understood by the system now. So you may see here, like I have spoken into English language, but ultimately it took with respect to the language that I'm that language setting that is used there. So if I go here and if I change primary language to be English, and then if I start now speaking, everything would be typed by it, depending upon how exactly it is going to understand what I said. Now, whenever there is a problem in understanding, it will type something else. Correct, but you will see, like it is trying to type everything. Correct, whatever I'm speaking, it is trying to convert it into text. So like a speech to text conversion. Now, other cases, so let me stop this. Now, let me talk about now transliteration. What exactly we mean by transliteration. So if I have to type a message in Marathi, so like using Marathi keyboard is very tough for us. So what they came up with? They came up with some form of transliteration. So I wrote AAJ, AJ, MI, me. Now when I type lecture, it says lecture, because it is not understanding what exactly it means. Okay, because it is the word that I'm talking. So AAJ, me, class. So, okay, sorry. Let me go to this. AAJ, me, class. Now you can see I wrote class. It took. Genar, G-H-E-N-A-R. So whatever I'm typing, it is transliterated and displayed. So it is not having any restriction on how exactly it is. And sometimes people may write like this only. Like if I set up a language to be English. AAJ, me, class, Genar, sorry. Now, if I type in or key in this text, ultimately you will see this doesn't fit into some of the words are not fitting into English language. But whatever I wanted to communicate to you, it was understood. Correct? So there is no form, like no restriction. Like whenever you are going in the class and you are asked a question by your teacher, and then you are answering to that question. When you are answering that question, ultimately, if teacher doesn't understand what you are saying, it says what exactly you want to speak. But think of a kid, a very small kid, rather of say 0 to 2 months age. If he like starts crying, or he or she starts crying, our reaction is he or she must be hungry. So there might be multiple reasons, but only mother can understand what exactly. There is no structure formed. So our like as a father, like I'm giving you my experience. As a father, I know only like whenever a kid starts crying, possible two reasons. Either there is some kind of pain in his one of the body part, or he is hungry. But the mother of the child can only understand without any specific structure. I'm acting as a machine who is a father. But at the same time, whenever I'm talking about a mother point of view, there is no structure required to understand what exactly he or she is reacting upon. Mother can understand it. So that's why there is no structure required whenever you are trying to communicate to mother. But whenever you're talking with, you must have an experience as well like this. Rather, while you are speaking with your father, you need to be very specific. And whenever you are talking with mother can understand either even with respect to your reactions, your emotions, and so on. And that's one positive aspect of it. Okay, so let us try to restrict now again the language. So we are saying type 3. Let me come up with now next one. So this type 3 is called as regular grammar. Now here, like you saw, there was no restriction. some specific restriction, again a specific restriction with only one variable to be here. Let me add one more restriction here. Two. Fine. So the restriction says, rather I should say, this is most restricted one. What it does is, towards left side, there should be a single variable. There should be a single variable. And right side can contain something like this. Either a single terminal or a terminal and a variable, or terminal and non-terminal. So where A comma B belongs to Vn and A belongs to sigma. They can be any variables. This can be any terminal. But your production would be of this form. Correct. So we said, we came up with this. This was first. Then this was second. This was third form. And this was fourth form. This was fourth form. And then, like, these languages, like, for example, this would be the grammar. Now, whenever grammar is, you are going to come up with, like, we had a syntax of a particular language. Using that language, we generate statements. They would be part of your language. From the grammar, we generate statements. From the syntax, like, what are the statements those are generated, you check whether it is it syntactically correct or not. Spoken languages. Now, if I'm trying to speak something where I don't care what whether I'm following the grammar or not, but if I can reach to your end, we don't care about the grammar. And that's where we do talk about unstructured grammar. Now, you must have seen, like, AICT took a decision on teaching engineering into local languages, the mother tongue of the particular student. Now think of this, like, engineering is taught in Marathi. Your mathematics course is taught in Marathi. We saw that even, like, some of the teachers taught us in primary level, at primary level. You remember the words which were used by them at that time. Now you may laugh now because you came to know now new words, which are the proper words associated with it. Correct. Now let us come up with these things. Like, we saw there is a hierarchy, type 0, type 1, type 2, type 3, given by your scientist Noam Chomsky hierarchy. So where he used a grammar definition to distinguish between the types of grammars. Okay, for this type 0, type 1, type 2, type 3. So for that purpose, we said how the grammar would be. Grammar would be defined using four tuples, Vn, sigma, Ps. Now, in some books, rather, this Vn may be replaced by T, capital T, set of non-terminals. Okay, but, like, I'm going to make use of some specific specific symbols like this, Vn, sigma, Ps. Vn would be non-empty set of variables or non-terminals. Sigma would be set of symbols or terminals. Okay, then Vn intersection sigma is always going to phi. P would be set of productions or rules of the form alpha gives beta, where alpha beta belongs to Vn and sigma star. There would be S, special start symbol. S belongs to Vn. So at least whenever you are talking about a grammar, grammar cannot be empty. At least one variable should be there. That's why we said non-empty setup. Now suppose I start my class and I mute everything and I don't write anything. And you were asked, like, you be there in the class. I'm going to monitor your attendance. I'm not speaking anything. You are not speaking anything. So class was done at 10 o'clock. We started at 9. We ended at 10. Were there variables? Yes. Class was supposed to start. So that was the first variable, which was our start variable. I started the meeting. So that was our start. I haven't spoken anything. You haven't spoken anything. Everyone was muted. I even have muted my mic. Nobody is speaking. Language would be empty. Okay, so you are going to make use of this grammar to generate set of strings, which would be part of a language. So if at all I define a language, L-A-N-G-U-A, जी लैंग्वेज एल ओवर ग्रामर जी इज सेट अप स्ट्रिंग्स. सेट अप स्ट्रिंग्स derived from the grammar. Now you may say we are coming up with now a new definition. What is derived? Okay, so this would be the language. So the language should come up with set. Language should come up. It is kind of a set of strings which are derived or which are generated using the grammar. Correct. Then we said there would be these four types: type 0, type 1, type 2, type 3. We distinguish them with respect to the format of the production. So we said first format would be alpha gives beta, where alpha beta belongs to BN union sigma star. They can be any symbols. Alpha and beta can be any symbols. It is called as unstructured or to be specific, recursively enumerable. Okay, so we are talking about grammars now, or these are production types. Now, if the grammar contains this, right, all productions are of this form, then it would be type 0 grammar. Similarly, type 1 production is this form: alpha A beta gives alpha gamma beta, where length of alpha is less than equal to length of gamma. A should be from VN. Alpha and beta would be left and right context. Okay, so let us try to show that this would be left context and this would be right context. Now these contexts are to be preserved depending upon the grammar and the language requirement. Fine. Now this A should never produce epsilon. That results to say that gamma can never be epsilon. So that's why I wrote gamma cannot be epsilon. Epsilon means an empty string, right, which we talked about in our previous session. Now other type is type 2. Type 2 grammar or type 2 production, a production of the form A gives alpha is called as type 2, where A belongs to VN and alpha belongs to VN union sigma star. So if your productions, all productions of the given grammar has this form, then it is called as context-free grammar. We saw application perspective, NLP and programming languages heavily use this type 2, context-free grammar. Now last type or category is type 3, where the production is of the form A gives AB or A. So this A is a variable, this B is a variable, and this small a is a terminal. So A and B can be a variable and small a can be part of sigma. Every production should have this form. Now when I said A gives alpha, this alpha can be very big string because we said VN union sigma star. Now here we are restricting it only a terminal or a terminal and a non-terminal. In this case we said this can be a beta or sorry this can this gamma can be again a string, so we don't know what would be the length. Here we are having a restriction. That's what I said, this is too restrictive language or too restrictive grammar. Now the language for these grammars, like recursively enumerable language, is defined as set of strings which can be generated from type 0 grammar or unstructured grammar. Similarly, a context sensitive language is defined as set of strings which can be generated or produced or derived from the context sensitive grammar given. Same thing, context free language is a language containing set of strings which are derived from the given context free grammar. Regular language is a language which contains set of strings which can be derived by or derived from the given regular grammar. Fine. So now we gave the names to the languages, so let me write the names. So first is recursively enumerable language. Okay, then we said context sensitive language. Then next is context free language, and then lastly regular language. Now let me try to relate them, like, and then we will stop. Let me try to relate them with the machines. Okay, so with the machines that we talked about in the first session. So this recursively enumerable language, the machine associated with it is Turing machine. Context sensitive language is linear bounded machine or automaton. Context free language is pull down automaton, and regular language heavily depends on finite automaton. So when I said languages, I also mean by the grammar. So unstructured grammar or recursively enumerable grammar is associated with Turing machine. Context sensitive grammar associated with linear bounded automata. Context free grammar is related with push down automata, and regular grammar is related with finite automata. So in next session, our target would be to find out how exactly we say a string is derived from the grammar. Fine. So we will see different techniques. Rather, when I say techniques, we are going to see how to derive a string from the given grammar. So we would be given a grammar and we are asked to generate strings. Second set of problem would be, we are given language, we are asked to generate. So with this, I will stop here. If there are any questions, queries, you can please ask. Please ask your question.